Hi, I'm Miles O'Brien, the PBS NewsHour science correspondent, and I'm joined by Colonel Chris Hadfield, noted astronaut and author of a new book, An Astronaut's Guide to Life on Earth, What Going to Space Taught Me About Ingenuity, Determination, and Being Prepared for Anything. That subtitle is as long as some books, by the way.
Just some, you know, early space flights. Yeah. Yeah.
And so we're going to share with folks out there, when we told the Twitterverse, the social networking world that we were talking to you, that naturally a lot of questions came up. So Let's go through as many as we can here.
I'll give it a shot.
John Marcus has this one. Have your bones re-strengthened? Along those lines, will people ever be able to explore vast space? So he's talking about adaptation back.
Sure. We have almost beat the problem of osteoporosis due to space flight. And the bones through my whole body stayed at their original density, except across my hip cradle and my upper femur. And it's growing back. And within about a year of landing, it'll be back where it was. I lost about 8% of the soft bone, which is a lot. But it's the improvements in our equipment on board that have got so that the rest of my skeleton is strong. And I think we just need to make one more iteration of changing the treadmill and improving the weightlifting device. And then I think we will have beat that problem. So I don't think bone density will be a limitation for indefinite space flight.
Molly Sparber has this. What was it like for the commander when he got to tweet with the Star Trek actors in character?
I thought it was just fun. You know, I grew up loving that whole idea and being inspired by them. So the people that get to talk to Leonard Nimoy and Bill Shatner from space, it was just a fun delight.
Gareth Mugridge asked this. What would you say was the most profound realization about our planet that you came to on your mission?
I could not avoid the creeping and pervasive feeling of a shared occupation of the Earth, a shared responsibility for the Earth, kind of a feeling of us everywhere. Not just the town I'm from or the city or the country I'm from, but you just see the same pattern repeated over and over around the world. And I started actually unconsciously referring to everybody as us. This is where a million of us live, right here. And it was an interesting change in my fundamental perspective, and one that I really tried with all the pictures to share to the best of my ability with everybody.
All right, a guy who goes by the handle James Jimmy Jim says this. My 8-year-old nephew asked me what space smells of. Does it smell of anything?
You're inside the spaceship most of the time. The only time you could smell space is when you come back in from a spacewalk. And as you repressurize the airlock and open the hatch, there's a distinctive smell to it. And it smells a little bit like being on a shooting range, like that sort of lingering gunpowder cordite smell. So maybe a little bit like brimstone. That's what space smells like.
It's remnants from the Big Bang, no doubt,
perhaps,
I guess.
Yeah.
Daniel Markin asks this. Do you get startled when you wake up because you are weightless? Ever have dreams that you are falling in space?
I never had dreams I was falling. And this watch right here woke me up every morning. It's got a loud, piercing alarm.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew where I was every morning. It is a complete adaptation to living in space so that I woke up and I would immediately turn on my little laptop and read the news of the day. And your eyes are all gummy because they haven't drained during the night, so they have nice big print. But no, I didn't have odd dreams, and I woke up ready for each day the whole time I was up there.
All right, here's where we where art and reality meet. Jim Kennedy wants to know, what is your opinion of gravity?
If you want to see what it looks like to do a spacewalk, just immerse yourself in what they created for gravity. That's what being in space looks like. The storyline is, you know, it's a Hollywood, it's like watching Spider-Man or something. You don't expect it to be real.
So fairly close to what you saw through your visor during a spacewalk?
I've done 2 spacewalks, and I've been around the world 10 times outside the spaceship. And yeah, nothing has taken me back to the visual grandeur of what it's like to be in space compared to the movie Gravity. I don't know how they did it, but it's beautifully done.
From Facebook, how was your recording of David Bowie's song accomplished? How was the sound captured in real time, and who helped with coming up with the final product back on Earth?
I recorded the audio using a microphone through to my iPad with GarageBand on it. And originally, I just listened to Bowie in one ear and did like a karaoke version of the tune. And then I sent my voice down to people on the ground. They put the instrumentals in and sent the instrumentals back up to me. And then I just put that as a track on GarageBand, and then I just put my voice as tracks on top of GarageBand. So I did that separately. And then once I had all the audio, then of course, just like any rock video ever, you just get the audio playing loud in the studio, set up your video camera, and you just sing along with it. And so I floated around holding a video camera, singing along with myself.
Ground control to Major Tom.
And then that one shot in the cupola with the world in the background, if you look close, you can see I have a big light right here and a big light right here, because that was the only way to get my face bright enough that you could see it against the world. So look close at that next time. You'll see the weird lighting I had to set up just to be able to see what was going on.
Were you surprised at how popular it became, viral it went?
I was stunned at the reaction. I thought, hey, that's a nice recording. But when I look at the video, I kind of see me floating around a space station. But for everybody else, that combination is kind of surreal. The beauty of it is it's both real and fantasy all folded together. So I'm amazed at the number of people that have seen that around the world.
Final thought on the David Bowie thing. Why that song? Why that artist?
It was really popular demand. My son, Evan, who really helped with the social media, he started sending me notes as I got to space saying, Dad, you got to record Space Oddity. Everybody wants you to. It's iconic. And I was against the idea. It just didn't seem to me like a song. I've never performed it before. It's kind of a strange, ethereal song, and the astronaut dies at the end. It just didn't seem like a good choice. But the demand was consistent and huge, and so I did it because my son asked me.
You listened to your fans,
I
right?
Did.
Including
I did
your
indeed.
Son.
Yeah.
All right. Chris Hadfield, thank you very much.
Thanks, Miles.